up on Tech News Today, HTC promises to fix their Android leak, and we've got new phones from Microsoft. Oh, right, and a rumor about one from Android and the iPhone 4S. All that and more coming up.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is TWiT.
Bandwidth for Tech News Today is provided by Cachefly at cachefly.com.
This is Tech News Today for Tuesday, October 4th, 2011. Tech News Today is brought to you by Squarespace.com, the fast and easy way to create a high-quality website or blog. For a free trial and 20% off your new account for 6 months, go to Squarespace.com, use the offer code TNT10, and by Gazelle, the easy way to sell or recycle the used gadgets lying around your home or office. Gazelle, your used gadgets today at Gazelle.com. Welcome to Tech News Today. I'm Tom Merritt.
I'm Sarah Lane.
I'm Iyaz Akhtar.
I'm Jason Howell.
And joining us, Becky Worley is back on the show.
Hey,
how's it
Becky.
Going?
I'm joining you from my throne here.
What is that? Where are you?
I'm deep in the bowels of Yahoo.
Ah, okay.
Yes.
That's
hence the yellow and the purple.
That's the standard issue chair, is it?
Pretty much, yeah.
The big this yellow Disney chair.
The scary button to see on the elevator, bowels.
Also joining us, the man on the panel who was actually in Apple's announcement today, editor-in-chief of Engadget.com, Mr. Tim Stevens. Welcome to the West Coast, Tim.
Thank you very much. I was there today. I am not, however, in a big yellow throne. I'm sorry to say.
I'm sorry. We'll try to get one to you by the end of the show.
That would be fantastic. Thank
you. Yeah, Becky, if you could make that happen. Of course, first third or less of the show will be the iPhone announcement. We'll try not to repeat too much of what you've already heard. Just give you the specs, give you our take on stuff, and move through it. But, you know, it's an important announcement. I think the biggest part of the announcement for me was Tim Cook revealing his love of giant squirrels.
Squirrel. It gets your attention, okay? And you got a good camera. You can see.
That was the picture.
According to Phil Schiller, it's very hard to take pictures of squirrels because they like to move, which is, I think, no surprise to anybody. But
That is Phil Schiller, right? You're right.
It was funny how he was like, do you have any idea how hard it is to take a picture of a squirrel?
I think we do,
that's
Phil.
The standard by which cameras are measured.
I think if we all think about it, we'll come to the same conclusion.
This is your picture off of Engadget.com, Tim. Were there as many snickers in the audience there when that came up as there were when we saw it on your live blog?
There were definitely some snickers. Yeah, that was Darren Merritt's picture from our live blog. And yeah, there were some snickers there. There was some curious applause at interesting times. People were clapping for things like squirrels. People clapped for Mickey Mouse when they showed the Mickey Mouse watch face. Apparently, that was all that it took to get people excited today.
Well, and, you know, it was a different audience, right? Because they were down on the Cupertino campus in Apple's theater. It's a smaller room than the Moscone Center, where they usually like to do these sorts of things. Of course,
they couldn't
get Moscone because of Oracle World. Was it a different atmosphere? In addition to that, was it a different atmosphere than it is when Steve Jobs was the CEO?
It's hard to say how much was the, you know, Tim Cook versus Steve Jobs. Tim Cook definitely had a different presentation style than Steve Jobs. Tim was much, you know, more understated, a little more calm, it seemed. You know, he wasn't quite jumping on the hyperbole bandwagon as much as Steve Jobs did. But Tim looked very comfortable up there. Certainly, you know, he did a very good job at the presentation today. But things did feel very different. I think largely because it was such a small place, a much more intimate experience than at Moscone, where they usually do the iPhone analysis. So it was much quieter and much more low-key, but that's partly because of the news, I think, too.
Yeah, it was still an hour and a half announcement, but the key part of it came 54 minutes in. The iPhone 4S is the new iPhone. It will come out in the United States, Canada, and a select few other countries on October 14th. You'll be able to start pre-ordering it October 7th, coming in a 16-gigabyte model for $199. 32 gigabyte for $299, 64 gigabyte for $399. And it will be available not only on AT&T and Verizon, but also on Sprint. 22 more countries by the 28th of October and 70 countries by the end of the year. And essentially what's different about it is the insides. The design is almost exactly the same as the iPhone 4. A5 chip, dual-core Cortex-based processor inside, so it's a step up from the A4. Battery life is about the same. They will give you HSDPA, so you'll get up to 14.4 megabits per second, theoretically, by access. It's a world phone, dual chip. That Qualcomm dual chip did show up in there, GSM and CDMA. Great camera, 8-megapixel sensor, lots of good stuff for folks who like taking pictures, f2.4 aperture, IR filter, claiming it's only going to take... What's that?
Squirrels really love it.
Squirrels love it. 1.1 seconds to take the first photo, 1080p video, AirPlay mirroring for games, and the big announcement is that for the iPhone 4S, you'll get voice recognition from Siri that is more expanded than the Siri app that you could get up till now. And I've been trying to play with my Siri app all day, and all it says is retrieve failed. Siri could not download required information from the server. So I think everybody else is trying to do this at the same time. So there you go. That's the new iPhone 4S. Round the horn, Sarah Lane, what do you think?
Well, I thought my first reaction was, why isn't Tim Cook telling us about the 4S? I mean, he wasn't the one that rolled out all those features on stage, and I thought that that was curious. That said, I know that there were a lot of rumors, maybe the screen will go to, it'll be stretched out to each side, it might be thinner, teardrop shaped, new color. There were all sorts of rumors. On the outside of it doesn't really make much difference to me. I think the iPhone 4 is a really nice design. On the inside is where it's important. I use my iPhone as a camera multiple times a day, so a better camera is really important to me. Having stuff snappier is really important to me. I love the idea of Siri. I don't think it's going to make me go get the 4S right now, but I'm excited to see how people start using it. It's an incremental step, right? It's like the 3GS.
It reminds me of that announcement, definitely.
So there's been a lot of complaints. I can't believe it wasn't the 5. Why does it matter? I mean, it is what it is.
Well, that's the question, too. Is it that it doesn't have a different design and it's not called 5, that there's this palpable... Are we that shallow? I mean, because if you just list the specs, it does seem like a notable, evolutionary. It's not revolutionary, it's evolutionary. But is it just that it lacks an exterior change and a model number change that people are disappointed?
I think part of the reason
is just the change that people were looking for. I think people were looking for a bigger screen for one thing. A 4-inch screen is pretty standard on the Android front at this point. So, if you're used to an Android device and you go down to an iPhone 4 or 3.5, actually feels a little bit small. So I think that's one thing that people were looking for. But ultimately, I mean, the iPhone 4 is definitely a very nice design, very nice hardware. But it does feel a bit dated now. And after 18 months, I think people were ready for something truly new. And it is certainly new on the inside, and the new camera is great too, but it is still very much the same phone.
I think the 4S pretty much is Apple's response to the vast amount of Android phones out there. When you look at the specs on Android phones, I mean, if you're a nerd and you're paying attention to the specs, you're like, well, that's just a single core. This is actually a dual core. And there's a lot of Android devices out there with dual core processors, and that becomes a determining factor when you want to do these kinds of things. I know I got to play with a couple of other phones recently, and the camera speed thing is actually really important to me. Mm-hmm. So, like, even though it's a minor upgrade, it's an 8-megapixel from a 5-megapixel camera, that maybe to some people that's not a lot. To me, that's a big deal. 1080p recording, I like that on a phone. Just the speed at which it can take photos, that's a big deal. Because, like, I'm trying to take a picture of a kid, and then he's moving around, and now it's a blurry shot.
Well, that's the whole thing about the iPhone, is that it's more and more becoming your video camera, mm-hmm. your point-and-shoot, plus a bunch of fun apps.
That's true.
And
smartphones
a
in general.
Exactly. I mean, any smartphone wants to be all of those things. So it's kind of Apple catching up here.
Tim, you were the only one who actually got your hands on one at the event. And you were telling us before the show, it looks pretty much exactly the same as the iPhone 4. How was it to use?
It was definitely a bit snappier. The iPhone 4 was certainly not a sluggish phone by any means, but things were a bit quicker to use on the 4S. So you can definitely notice the speed improvement, but I don't think that you'll really feel a difference until you're getting into some high-end 3D gaming like Infinity Blade 2 they showed off from Epic, which looked fantastic. Unfortunately, we weren't able to play that. I was able to take some pictures on the thing, and it was very responsive. I mean, we've seen devices like the Droid Bionic just launched, which has, a hugely long shutter lag. If you're trying to take pictures, it takes seconds and seconds, which is way too long.
It's horrible on the Bionic.
Yeah, Yeah, the 4S was very quick to bring up the camera app and very quick to focus and to take pictures. But I have to say, the few pictures that I was able to take on the camera didn't exactly blow me away. They definitely looked still like they were from a camera phone. We saw some phenomenal pictures, like the picture of the squirrel. They looked amazing. But you can take some pretty amazing pictures with even a low-res camera phone if you've got everything, you know, everything lined up perfectly. So I think we'll have to wait and see exactly how that camera performed in the real world. But the new backside illuminated sensor should make it much better in low-light situations. The other thing that I got to spend quite a bit of time with was Siri, which you mentioned before. And I was actually quite impressed. I tried to confuse it as much as I could. And it never skipped a beat. It gave me directions to the top ramen place in San Francisco. It gave me the history of my hometown in Vermont.
Wow.
Let me send two text messages to myself that I transcribed by voice, and every word was absolutely perfect.
When you say you tried to confuse, you tried to confuse it as you talk really fast or
divide by
make
zero.
A funny voice.
Did you go for a jog?
I tend to talk pretty. I did not go for a jog. Actually, I do tend to talk pretty quickly as it is. So it did fine, but it was a pretty noisy room that we were in, and it didn't have any issues. The only time that I had a problem was when I hit the button twice, and it only picked up half of what I said. But even I did that once before, and I was talking for way too long, and it still managed to figure out what I was trying to say and give me back the information that I wanted. So, like I said, Tom, I don't think it's going to revolutionize anything. You know, it's not exactly leaps and bounds beyond the Siri app from before, but I do think it is a nice new feature.
Yeah, Siri also seemed like another catch-up kind of thing. I know a friend of mine had an Android device like last year, and he's like, directions to this place, and I was like, how do you do that? That's impressive. I haven't seen that on an iPhone.
Yeah, but the real kind of conversational parsing that Siri is doing is a little bit different from some of the things that I've seen. There's an app on Android called Vlingo that does a lot of this stuff. And my experience has been very mixed with it. I guess it remains to be seen how awesome Siri will handle all this stuff.
There's also a big question about whether or not people are willing to really talk to their phones. We hate talking on our phones. Totally. Are we really going to talk to our phones in that kind of everyday use case that they set up? I mean, I believe Apple will do it right, so I have faith in it and can't wait to test it out while jogging, while driving. But I'm just wondering about sort of the human computer interface actions and whether we'll really feel comfortable doing that.
Yeah, I think maybe while driving is one of the better use cases for it. Go ahead.
Absolutely. There was one issue, though, in that a lot of the examples that we were given, Siri would give you the response on the screen. So, for example, he asked for what $42 in euro is, I think, something like that. And Siri did find the correct response, but it only showed it on the screen. So if you happen to be driving and you need to know, you know, do a currency exchange, it's not going to read it back to you. It would read, like, text messages to you and help you schedule calendars by voice purely. But there are a lot of things that you needed to actually look down at the screen for with Siri. So I think that's one issue that I think Apple is going to have to address to make it, you know, a purely eyes-off device so you can speak to the device and have it speak back to you as well.
I got to say, though, I love the idea of setting my alarm just by voice. There's an alarm clock that does that right now. And it's so much, for some reason, setting the alarm is strangely challenging late night with the, you know, the. So I think will be a really cool use case. I mean, after 7 or 8 beers, Tom, I'm just saying.
Right.
If it can recognize the slurred speech, it's going to be good.
Of course, the other news is that the iPhone 4 now goes to $99. They'll continue to sell the 8-gigabyte version of that. You'll also be able to get the iPhone 3GS free with contract. So if you can afford the smartphone fees, you can get a free iPhone. It's an older iPhone, but you still get a free one. And my take on it is essentially, if you don't have an iPhone already, or maybe you have an iPhone 3G or older, you probably want to look at upgrading the iPhone 4S. If you're in contract, I think you stick it out. Even the 3GS is probably okay for a little while longer. Definitely if you have an iPhone 4, there's no reason to rush out and get the iPhone 4S, in my opinion.
Well, unless
you're on Sprint.
Well, if you're on Sprint, then you don't have the iPhone yet, theoretically.
Well, but that's what I'm saying, is that I think the Sprint thing is a big deal for people, and
Sprint has really bought
$20 billion worth of these phones. I mean, this is going to be a big play from them.
Yeah, exactly.
It was very surprising to us that Sprint was mentioned almost as an afterthought.
They didn't make a big deal out of it, did they?
Just kind of thrown out there, oh, yeah, it's coming to Sprint, which for Sprint users, obviously, is a huge deal. And if these rumors of Sprint paying billions of dollars to get the iPhone are true, and you know, there's no reason to believe that they're not. I got to feel that Sprint's got to feel a little bit burned today, that they just barely were noticed at all today. They certainly weren't any part of the announcement at all.
Maybe if Sprint had ordered 60 trillion phones, they would have had a much larger thing. I mean, I think they ordered 30 million phones.
That was the rumor. 20 billion. I don't know.
Well, that was just enough to get 5 seconds. Oh, yeah, we're on Sprint.
You get your logo.
More expensive than a Super Bowl ad right there.
The 4S is also going to sell for a lot of people who were in contracts who didn't get to take advantage of, you know, the iPhone coming to Verizon earlier this year, for example. Now's a better time for a lot of people. So I think we're going to see a lot of people shifting carriers based on who they like the best.
I think Siri is also iPhone 4S only, right?
Well, as far as we know, yeah. They mentioned it in the iPhone 4S part of the keynote, not in the iOS 5 part of the keynote. Right.
I think they would have made that distinction.
Yeah. The first 54 minutes were about all kinds of other things, including a recap of what's coming in iOS 5. iOS 5 releases will work on the iPhone 4, the 3GS, the iPad 2, the iPad, the iPod Touch 3rd Gen and higher, and will be available as a free download October 12th, including the exciting new Cards app that lets you create greeting cards on your iPhone for free and send the images via snail mail for $3 to $5.
This is kind of the lead, too, right? This is the lead.
Who'd you send your card to, Tim?
To myself, actually, and I cannot wait to see if I actually get a card. Yes, thank you, I do. I took a picture of my camera, actually, with the phone and sent myself a lovely greeting card. Yes, so I can't wait to have a picture of my Nikon.
So $3 within the U.S., $5 internationally.
That's right.
Grandparents everywhere thanking Apple.
Exactly.
Find My Friends app will be able to see where your family is, allow for temporary sharing, some privacy controls. iCloud will launch with iOS 5 on October 5th, and that will allow you to, October 12th, and that will allow you to take advantage of storing docs up to 5 gigabytes in the cloud. iTunes Match, which is the service that will take anything you've bought from the iTunes store and automatically store it in the cloud for you, won't launch until the end of October. They're not putting a date on that. And for the non-iTunes songs that you have in your library, it will cost you $24.99 a year. And as Tim mentioned, Infinity Blade 2 coming December 1st. Was anybody excited about the iPod announcements? They mentioned that the Shuffle's going to continue at $50. They made no mention of the Classic one way or the other. The Nano gets a pedometer, which means you don't have to have the dongle from Nike if you want to have it track you while you jog.
That's cool for people who are really into the fitness side of it.
And the iPod Touch is available in white.
Yeah, that was so
24
lame.
Watch faces for the Nano.
Sorry, right? I almost forgot.
Including Mickey Mouse.
Mm-hmm.
What is the iPod Touch?
Okay, so it didn't get any thinner, which is fine because it's impossible to get that thing thinner.
Right.
But they didn't upgrade the cameras or the processor. So there's a huge, huge gap between the 8-megapixel camera on the iPhone 4S and the sub 1-megapixel camera that's on the iPod Touch. They could have made it a little bit different. I mean, there's a larger gap growing there. The pricing plan is genius, I think. At $200 for an 8-gigabyte model, people are just going to get that that's the Kindle Fire competitor right now.
But imagine if they upgrade the iPod Touch too much. Too many people will say, well, I don't think I really need an iPhone because I've got almost everything available on my Touch. So having the two be distinct different
little
products
bit of distance,
might be
maybe
good for
a
Apple.
Strategy, yeah. Mm-hmm. A lot of things we didn't see. We did not see a true LTE or WiMAX phone. We did not see a big change in the way the phone looked. We did not see a Facebook app. MG Siegler on TechCrunch reporting that Facebook was not invited and will have their own app announcement later this week. We didn't... anything else we were maybe expecting?
No NFC.
No NFC. You get Bluetooth 4.0, which I think is the way Apple's going to go with their payment system, if they ever do that. But yeah, we didn't see anything about using your phone to buy stuff. Anything else we expected to see that we missed?
Well, one thing I was wondering what you guys thought. You all saw that really great video of all the cases that are flooding the market that are, you know, all this 33% thinner, the teardrop design, 4-inch screen. Do we think, you know, these were all supposedly based on a stolen prototype. Do you guys think that Apple was playing the case makers? Do you think this is sort of a ruse that they were involved in that?
Well, what would they get out of that? Because all it did was create a media frenzy so that people were expecting a phone that was
They get disappointed when that doesn't get announced.
It could just be to weed out whoever's leaking information. Now they fired a whole bunch of people, I bet, when they saw those cases go out and they're like, wait a minute, we told so-and-so about this teardrop shape. You're fired.
My thinking is, Apple probably has a lot of prototypes for a lot of different kinds of phones that they're constantly working on. They're probably working on the iPhone 5 and the iPhone 6 and the iPhone 7.
True.
And maybe that's what somebody got a hold of. And that may not end up ever being what an iPhone looks like.
And then the second question on that, though, Tom, is did Apple manage expectations if people were expecting this huge design change and a new iteration of the phone? Yeah. Is this a failure of PR on their part? I mean, because generally the general population right now is seeing disappointed. It's not what we thought it would be.
Yeah, but that's every Apple announcement. Almost every Apple announcement starts with like, I really wasn't that impressed. And then within a week, when it's time to pre-order, they bring down the site.
I've never seen the mainstream media so wrong as they were this time. I mean, and I'm not saying that the mainstream media isn't wrong a lot, but I mean, from Scoble to all the people who are anticipating, you know, these big changes, I'm just surprised. This does seem like the biggest chasm between the expectations.
Although
and
everything
the
that was announced was also rumored, so I mean, you spread enough rumors, some of them are going to be right.
Maybe
just that the rumors weren't exciting enough. So
stop clocks right
twice
a day.
People made up other things.
These
people familiar with
iPhone
the matter just weren't that familiar, in my opinion.
That's right. And Apple had a hard time keeping their site up. People were obviously excited to go look at this thing. Apple.com was down most of the morning. You couldn't even get to it.
So many access denied. You want to see specs on things? No.
All right, let's take a break and get to some non-Apple news. There's some more great phone news coming at you. This episode brought to you by Squarespace.com, the fast and easy way to create a high-quality website or blog. You want to start a fan site for the iPhone? You want to start a hate site for the iPhone? You want to start an Android site, a hate Android site, any kind of site? Start it at Squarespace. Easy-to-use UI. You can try it out for free. You don't have to use a credit card, and see how easy it is to create a high-quality, professional-looking site that is reliable. That's the advantage of Squarespace over other services, is you get personal help 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. You get templates that look professional that you can tweak to your satisfaction. You don't have to know any CSS, although they allow you to do that. It's the best of both worlds. If you want to use the plugins, you can do that, or you can code things yourself. Customize it the way you want. And don't forget that if you sign up for a free account, you don't need a credit card to try it out. You can import your blog, see how it looks. And if you like it, you can keep it for 20% off for 6 months. Just use the offer code TNT10 if you decide to keep the service. That's squarespace.com. Use the offer code TNT10. We thank them for their support of Tech News Today. HTC has admitted, yep, in fact, Android police were right about the leak in our Sense UI implementation. We talked about it yesterday on Tech News Today, and they are working on a patch. HTC said, we are working very diligently to quickly release a security update that will resolve the issue on affected devices. In our ongoing investigation into this recent claim, we have concluded that while this HTC software itself does no harm to customer data, there is a vulnerability that could potentially be exploited. They have not learned of any customers being affected by the vulnerability, but they're going to push a patch out over the air as soon as possible. Company said the patch will be released after a short period of testing, so we don't know exactly when it's coming, but they're sounds like they're rushing it as soon as possible. Artem Rusakovsky from Android Police, one of the guys who helped find this this vulnerability, said, look, I applaud HTC's desire to fix the situation quickly, but I do have to wonder whether the patch will simply apply some sort of an authentication scheme to the service while letting it continue to collect the same kind of data. In other words, why is all this data being collected in this log by HTC, and what other apps that we haven't discovered might have access to it?
Right, or might get be able to get through that whatever authentication scheme they end up slapping onto it.
Is this a worry that, you know, HTC is a little more vulnerable than other Android devices, or when this patch comes in, is everybody like, you know what, that's all we needed, we'll move on?
I mean, it probably has people panicked. Go with Tim.
I was just going to say, I think this will be one of those cases where people will probably forget that this ever happened very quickly after that patch comes out. This is obviously a big oversight by HTC, but they're doing the right thing. They responded openly. So I think that they're doing the right thing. I think that we'll have it fixed quickly, and I think this wave will move on.
I think one of the bigger problems with it, though, the panic that's involved, is that it was HTC's software that was causing this problem. This wasn't like a fault with Android. It was something with their Sense UI that caused this as an issue. So hopefully they'll resolve it and it'll be fine.
But I don't get that. I thought all those apps were supposed to be sandboxed anyways, so I don't understand how the Sense UI could override that. That just doesn't make sense.
They created a log. They created a log that allowed, accidentally allowed any Android app that requested internet access to their log. So HTC just put in their own logging software, essentially. And that's what Android police are asking. Like, why does this log exist?
Right.
Let's get some Windows Phone rumors. Since we're all out of Apple rumors, CEO Stephen Elop is quoted by Reuters saying at a conference that Nokia will introduce its first products,
plural,
with an S, based on Windows this quarter. Nokia World's coming up at the end of October, October 26th. So there's three potential devices being bandied around. We've talked about C-Ray before. That's the N9-looking version of Nokia's phone, except instead of Mego, it would have Windows Phone. Elop has actually showed off C-Ray before. Saber and Ace are other versions that are kicking around out there. And according to the My Nokia blog, the Ace will be equipped to work with HSPA Plus and be billed as Nokia's first 4G handset, launching exclusively on AT&T in Q1 of 2012. So that would leave the Saber and the C-Ray to launch this quarter, if that were true. Anybody got bets on what Nokia is going to announce next week or a couple weeks from now?
C-Ray is definitely a safe bet. I mean, we've been waiting for them to finally roll that out after that. But beyond that, yeah, it's definitely a question. Nokia definitely loves to have devices with QWERTY keyboards that slide out in interesting ways. So I would love to see if they can make that happen. But that remains to be seen. Definitely, if they're going to do it, though, Nokia World is the place to do it. We're only a few weeks away.
Tim, you're way off. I think they're going to do the Nokia N-Gage Part 7.
With a teardrop-shaped keyboard.
Hey, yeah, and it's going to have...
Side talking is never out of style, right?
Microsoft decided to make Mango available to 50% of all Windows Phone devices. They announced that on their blog today. So 50% of you are upset that you're still not getting it, but the rest of you are happy. And the HTC Radar and the Titan have gone on sale in the UK, according to the Register. So two Windows Mango phones hitting the shelves in the UK. You get first crack at them over there. Finally, the Samsung Nexus Prime leaked out in some alleged live shots on GSM Arena. The shot shows specs, HD resolution of a Super AMOLED screen confirmed at 720p, well, confirmed, but if you believe this picture, 4.6-inch diagonal screen, pixel density of 320 ppi, widely expected to be announced next week, October 11th, Samsung doing an event as part of CTIA down in San Diego that Google's logo is on the invitation for. Is this what we'll see next week, Becky? What do you think?
I have no idea. You know, I can honestly say that I have just completely lost track of what's going on in this field. At this point, I'm like been so focused on the Apple phones. I don't know.
Pass. It's time now. Now it's time to look at the Nexus Prime.
That's right.
I'm not ready.
You gotta go ice cream sandwich.
No.
There's no time to relax.
iPhone's today's news, or practically yesterday's news at this point.
Silly people who cover tech news every day at this level. My God, it's changed so much since I was doing the show every day.
It's important stuff.
Get the geeky guy in the hotel room to answer this question.
Oh, come on. I have a name, Becky. Thank you very much. Yes, I think we will be seeing Ice Cream Sandwich very soon. We actually saw a device that was running Ice Cream Sandwich just last week that was curiously sold on eBay. So we're not far off from finally seeing what that's going to look like. And I wouldn't be surprised if this piece of hardware came along with it. And what little we've seen looks nice. But, of course, that's a very small picture.
Yeah, so, it really is. Yeah. I mean, the big hint that I see here is the lack of the physical buttons, right, which is what they hinted at with Ice Cream Sandwich. Yeah. There have been a lot of rumors that it would be with or without. Some rumors that were saying it's going to have a slide-out keyboard. It's really hard to tell from this display.
And if you read the comment sections on anybody talking about the idea of not having hardware keys, people are really split. Some people are really upset at the idea of not having actual hardware buttons on the front of this.
Yeah, I'm not a fan of that move. I don't like that on Honeycomb. For whatever reason, it confused me to have the buttons rotating with the screen. I don't know why. It should be more intuitive, but I just don't like the feel of it. I definitely would like to have the buttons in the same place on the phone at all times. So, you know, we'll give it a shot and see what feels.
All right, let's move on to the news fuse.
You had to know I was going to.
That was awesome.
I forgot that existed.
Ladies and gentlemen.
Apple has exploded.
You can now start mourning the Zune HD.
I did that yesterday.
No, this time it's for real. WMPowerUser.com found a post on the Zune.net support site that confirms that Microsoft will no longer be producing Zune players. If you're a Zune user, Microsoft's message also said that the company will continue to honor warranties. The future of the Zune will be Windows Phone.
But will we ever see another brown device? Ever?
That's the question.
I don't know. I think maybe they've learned their lesson there.
What can brown do for us now?
Not much. If Samsung's Australian battle with Apple doesn't resolve soon, the country may never actually get the Galaxy Tab 10.1. Neil Young, an attorney for Samsung who's probably really tired of Southern man jokes, told a federal court that if Samsung doesn't get approval within 2 weeks to bring the Tab to the Australian market, the company may not launch it there at all. And missing the Christmas season would mean that the tablet is pretty much dead. Remember that the 10.1 has already been delayed for 2 months because of this lawsuit.
Steven Sinofsky posted yet another blog post on building Windows 8 blog, because he does that all the time. This time he explains why Windows 8 will use a start screen instead of the old start menu. He said that people in the know were moving away from the start menu and pinning their frequently used programs to the taskbar. The start screen is meant to be a connected dashboard. So to sum it all up, Microsoft cares about your time.
Is that what they're trying to tell us?
Well, sort of.
Buy it, Tim.
I don't know that I do. It definitely makes things more touch-friendly, but I don't really, I don't know. I've spent a little bit of time with that way of interacting with things, and I still want to go to the start menu personally. Maybe I'm just old-fashioned.
I want to go to the start menu for computer. Sometimes I just need to get that computer, you know, what used to be your hard drive, so that you can drill down into some menus there, and I miss that in Windows 8.
Also, of the issues that Windows has, is that really paramount? I'm just saying.
It's the start menu, Becky.
Yeah, it's the thing that you use all the time. Yeah, it's a fundamental change to the way that you launch applications. And I think, like I said, I think it'll be great on a tablet. But when I'm using a mouse, I'm not a big fan of it at this point. But I think that, you know, there's some time left before Windows 8 comes out. I think we'll be seeing quite a few changes still.
Well, Hotmail is going to make you feel a whole lot better because they're adding a whole bunch of features to clean up your inbox. First up, a one-click unsubscribe option. You tell Hotmail to get you unsubscribed, they take care of the rest. Hotmail will also be able to schedule cleanups of your inbox based on your rules. So if you just want the latest newsletter, the old ones get the boot. And flagging messages, pin them to the top of your list. Hotmail team calls this a war on gray mail. I have no idea what that means.
It's not quite blackmail. It's gray mail.
Before Gandalf gets really powerful. Yahoo has overhauled its video site and given a shiny new name, Yahoo Screen. The content is curated, meaning that humans are actually making the decisions of what's going to be spotlighted. And video categories feature videos from Hulu and CBS, which also makes it easier to find content without having to go to a bunch of different sites. Yahoo also announced it's creating 8 original short-form shows aimed at women.
All sponsored by the HTC rhyme. AT&T wants to make Android more accessible to the visually impaired by giving away a suite of apps called Mobile Accessibility Lite. The app suite provides audio cues and feedback to make navigating Android devices a lot easier. The suite will be available for free for a limited time, but AT&T didn't specify how long that is.
Researcher Nick Kubrilovic says Facebook is still tracking unsuspecting people via cookies. After learning of this, Facebook has called the tracking issue a bug, which was limited in scope, and they're working on a fix. So, what's so horrible about this bug? Well, Facebook could track you via cookie even if you didn't visit Facebook or click on a share or like button. That sounds pretty insidious to me.
If you're a Bank of America customer and you've been annoyed at some outages, the website continued to suffer sporadic outages yesterday, marking the 4th day that some customers had been locked out of all online services to check balances and pay bills, stuff like that. B of A spokesperson Tara Burke told the Register that the outages aren't related to hacking, they're not DOS attack, nothing security related. The majority of our customers are able to bank online, she said. There's no compromised customer information.
Right after an increase in debit card fees? Something here just does not jibe. This is a weird story that is just beginning to unfold, I think. Well, I don't buy it.
Completely unrelated to that. The EFF wants the Supreme Court to ban GPS tracking without a warrant, and now they've got a new ally, Roger L. Easton. He's credited as the principal inventor of a little thing called the Global Positioning System.
Never heard of it.
They filed their position in an amicus brief on Monday in the case, U.S. versus Jones, arguing that GPS tracking is far more invasive than other means of surveillance. The lower court in U.S. v. Jones found the placement of a GPS tracker on a car located on private property to be unconstitutional. The government then appealed.
All right. Let's check the randomizer, see what gets spit out.
Randomizer.
Why, look at that. It's our continuing coverage of invisibility cloaks. Researchers from the University of Dallas in Texas have hijacked the phenomena that makes you see water in the road on a hot day to make an invisibility cloak. And this is actually a one-molecule thick sheet of carbon nanotubes wrapped up into a cylindrical tube that has the density of air but the strength of steel. Those are my superpowers also. So it takes the same thing that when there's that heat differential on the road that causes the sky to be redirected to your eye and your brain says, I can't be seeing the sky in the road, so I'm gonna make that look like water to you. They use that same thing to bend light around an object so that you no longer see the object and it disappears. This is not theoretical, too. They're making it work.
That's just flat out amazing. The fact that we have continuing coverage of invisibility is a whole other issue. But
like Harry Potter didn't have to end at all.
Exactly.
It's coming to life.
All right, before we get to the calendar, real quick break to thank our other sponsor of today's show, Gazelle. You've heard about all these new phones that are going to be coming out. You're going to want to get some money to be able to afford those phones. And whether you ditch your old phone or you got some other gadgets lying around, you might want to inventory that stuff. Go to gazelle.com, put in the name of the gadget, answer some questions about the condition. They'll tell you whether they can pay you some money for it. And that's it. It's so easy. It's the easiest way to sell your gadgets and get cash fast. They will send you a PayPal payment or an Amazon gift card or a check in the mail, whatever you want. You print up the label to mail it right there on the website. You don't have to pay extra. You can have them send you a box if you want, but you got a box yourself. Slap that gadget in the box, send it off to them. They will get you your money as soon as they can get the gadget. In fact, sometimes if they look at it and they're like, you were too hard on the condition, they'll send you more money. That's happened in a couple of cases. So go check it out, gazelle.com. They'll even recycle stuff that isn't worth anything anymore if you just want to responsibly get rid of it. Go to gazelle.com. See how much your gadgets are worth. They're paying lots of money for gadgets like the Kindle, like old iPhones, MacBooks, anything you got lying around the house. And if you're wondering, they will securely delete all the information before they pass it on to be resold. So check them out, gazelle.com. We thank them for their support of Tech News Today. What's on the calendar, Sarah?
Well, today marks the launch of Rage! It's Software's post-apocalyptic first-person shooter that's been in development for, what?
It was a happy rage.
4 years?
Yeah.
Rage!
That startled me at first.
So that's really good news. Jazz rage. Long time in the making. Walmart and T-Mobile are planning to launch a $30 prepaid unlimited web and text plan on October 16th. It'll also include 100 minutes of talk, 10 cents per minute after that. So good deal for some folks. Happy 26th birthday to the Free Software Foundation, founded by Richard Stallman in 1985. Happy day. And a reminder,
give
of course.
Give him something free.
What's that?
Give him something free for the birthday.
Yeah, give him something for free. A reminder that the iPhone 4S pre-orders start this Friday, October 7th.
Let's check what's incoming. There it is. Something incoming. Oh, there it is. This one comes from JY in regards to Larry Ellison's comments on Oracle World. I work for an SaaS, software as a service provider, and our application tier is written entirely in Java. So a boost for Java processing is definitely welcome for us. We can't use those fancy pants languages like Ruby on Rails, as they tend to break down as your database gets more complex, which is a given in the enterprise market. Thanks for sharing that tidbit with us, JY. Good extra information about Larry Ellison's comments.
Got another. Hey, Tom, I have, sorry to interrupt, sorry, I have one incoming I wanted to add on the fly that just came out of the chat room from iPhone 83906. He says, my conspiracy theory about Bank of America, not true. He works there. They've had capacity issues due to end of quarter not hacked. So just, I'm just giving
credence. Why suddenly is this end of the quarter more capacious?
Ooh, you thicken the conspiracy plot when I thin it. Interesting, Merritt. Interesting.
Still a little cornstarch in the conspiracy soup.
Conservation of conspiracy.
We didn't want to end the show without something Kindle-related, though. So next email from Doug.
We're light on Amazon coverage today.
Let's just make it a well-rounded show, shall we? He says, I'm writing about the voicemail you received while purchasing the Kindle in Canada. They were correct that we don't get free shipping, but it's very fast for $10. Received the shipment in 2 days. Second, Amazon charges export fees for the $139 Kindle, now the old 6-inch model. It was around $31. That covers brokerage and duty taxes. This has happened for the last two orders from Amazon. I received a refund for these charges around 2 months later. So buying a Kindle in Canada is not that bad after all. P.S. Rumor has it that Best Buy Canada may be carrying the Kindle soon. Staples Canada already has it, but at $159.99 Canadian.
All right, that's it for the show. Thanks, everybody, on our Reddit, technewstoday.reddit.com. Folks like ComFixer87, Grizzly82, Captain Kipper, Lazion, and more submit stories there that you can vote up or down. Help us choose what we're going to cover each day. And thank you, Becky Worley and Tim Stevens, for joining us. Becky, let folks know what you're doing. You've got new shows out there that people may or may not be aware of.
I know I missed tech news today, but I'm still working on GMA and also at Yahoo. I have a weekly show, Upgrade Your Life, and you can check it out there. And you can always find me on Twitter, BWorley, and on Google Plus.
Great to have you back on the show, Becky. You're welcome back anytime. As are you, Mr. Tim Stevens. Always good to have you on the show as well. You got anything nifty going on in a gadget particularly you want to let folks know about?
Yeah, we're launching a tablet magazine called Distro very soon.
Awesome.
I can't say exactly when, but it's going to be coming very soon indeed, so look forward to that.
When you say tablet magazine, is that like a special section of the site that's sort of magazine style?
No, it'll be an application that you can install on your tablet and
an actual
download
magazine.
Versions.
Oh, that's awesome.
Magazine. That's cool.
So you'll be able to download basically highlights from the week. All the features that maybe you didn't have time to read during the week because there's so much other junk going on, you can download all that and find a comfy chair somewhere and read reviews and features and growing up geeks and things like that.
Hey, I'm looking forward to that.
Tim, you won't hold it against me, right, that I called you geeky guy in a hotel room, right?
Of course not. Absolutely
We can
not.
Have a professional relationship, right? Okay, just checking.
We certainly over. Can, yes.
The first editorial in Distro, it'll be all about that.
Yeah.
Fine, geeky guy in a chair.
The angry post-show emails that I'm going to have to deal with now. Thanks, everybody, for watching. You can find us on the web at twit.tv/TNT. You can email us, tnt@twit.tv, and give us a call. Our phone number is 260-TNT-SHOW. Mark Million from CNN will be joining us tomorrow. We'll see you then.